Despite major government crackdowns in Iran, mass protests are well into their second week over the death of 22-year-old Mahsa Amini. So with rumors of the Supreme Leader's failing health, could this be a true turning point for the nation? Amini died in northern Tehran hospital earlier this month, 3 days after being taken into custody by the so-called morality police, who accused her of violating dress codes. The police story? She suffered a heart attack from a pre-existing condition. But her family and clearly many others have serious questions. In response to the protest and widespread images being shared of women removing and burning their hijabs, headscarves, Iran's government has blocked internet access and social media platforms across the country. Nearly 80 people have been killed, hundreds have been arrested, including several journalists since protests began. Will they lead to real change? I'm joined by Tara Sonenshine, former Undersecretary of State for Public Diplomacy under Barack Obama, who's now professor of practice at the Fletcher School at Tufts, and Pardis Mahdavi, provost of the University of Montana and the author of Passionate Uprisings, Iran's Sexual Revolution. Pardis, Tara, thank you so much for being here. I really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us.
Tara, if I can start with you, is the death of Amini a game changer? Meaning, will it be looked back on as a moment like that street vendor in Tunisia who self-immolated, which led to both the revolution there and the Arab Spring? Will it be?
We hope so, but this has been a 40-year struggle, and we know the ups and downs of these uprisings and then harsh, harsh punishment. I think what may be different here is that this is not just women. These are men and boys coming out. It's a generational struggle. And we have an 83-year-old Ayatollah and a very conservative president. So this is going to be hard, but I do think there is some momentum here. And it has lasted a bit longer than even the best experts thought it would.
Pardis, is this different this time?
I think it is different this time. I think, you know, as Tara mentioned, what you're seeing today is a much larger and more widespread coalition in more than 55 different cities. You're seeing young and old. Certainly, this is led by the youth movement, both young men and women. But you're also seeing a breaking down of the urban-rural divide. You're seeing increasingly numbers of frustrated Iranians throughout the country speaking up and out against the regime.
But Tara, why is it different? I understand you're both describing objectively how it is different and how it's more inclusive, more widespread. But why is it that way this time? Just mad as hell and I can't take it anymore kind of thing?
Well, social media plays a role.
Yeah.
In the past, there's been really an attempt to black out any information. I think more information is seeping through to people's cell phones and word of mouth. I think also we're in a time in the world where women and girls, we've been in this struggle for a very long time. I think there's a sense of fighting for your rights and empowerment here. Again, though, we have to be careful. The Iranian president's going to go on television and is going to threaten decisive action and going to make it very clear that those who continue this will be met with force. There will be pro-government rallies. So this is far from over, but our voices now inside and outside the country really matter.
I want to talk about outside the country in a minute, but Pardis, describe to people what the morality police, who they are, and you would obviously know because as I read in the Washington Post, you had firsthand experience as a victim of the morality police. Who are they?
Absolutely. So the morality police are an arm of the police that were created when the Islamist regime came to power after the Iranian Revolution. Their charge technically is to commit and ensure right and forbid wrong. That is the charge that has been defined for them. Their scope includes policing moral behaviors. Given that the regime, the Islamist regime, came to power under a fabric of morality, you know, in, during the revolution, they came to power on a platform that was opposed to what they were calling Westoxication, or the loose morals of the West. And so an entire arm of the police was created to walk the streets of Iran and on occasion raid parties, ensuring that Iranian citizens were comporting with proper morality rules as defined by, for example, headscarves that revealed only what is called the oval part of the face, and other moral rules.
Pardis, before we leave this, you were teaching a class in, what, sexual politics in Tehran 15 years ago. Can you share briefly with people what happened to you?
So I was actually giving a lecture on my book, which was looking at what young people termed a sexual revolution in Iran. And 13 minutes into my lecture, I was taken off stage, pulled off stage forcibly by the morality police, and taken in. And of course, as you know, I wrote in my Washington Post piece, suffered at the hands of their brutality as well.
You know, Tara, in the piece that your colleague here, Pardis, wrote, she quotes what a saying that was on walls throughout Iran from Ayatollah Khomeini, which said, "The Islamic Republic is not about fun, it's about morality. There's no fun to be had in the Islamic Republic of Iran." For women in particular, fun is a very dangerous thing in Iran, no?
Yes, I was in Iran in the 1980s when I was with ABC News Nightline, and I came in full chador. I was very careful. It's a fear-inspiring atmosphere. Fun is so far from the reality of daily life. When people are just held to account for what you wear in the morning, your blue suit, your tie, your shirt, that will define your freedom to move around, your hair, your bangs. It's so hard for women in 2022 to even imagine that this could be a form really of holding people hostage.
So Tara, staying with you, you wrote in your piece in the Globe that the West has historically been slow to react when the Iranian people have the courage to stand up to this kind of sickness. Providing space for crackdowns, obviously. We know the President of the United States has spoken out in support of the protest. I think it was yesterday that Secretary of State Blinken said that he would work to ensure that, well, I guess what he called technical or technological help, I assume he means access to the internet, would be provided. I assume those are good things by your standard. Are they enough?
Their improvements. In 2009, I think many of us were disappointed when there was an opportunity again to provide aid and comfort to protesters. This time, I think we will see more sanctions, and sanctions do bite in Iran. They do most definitely create economic difficulties. I also think the cell technology support will enable the free flow of information. And it's a cat and mouse game with the internet. People get on, they get taken off. They get on, they get off. And we need to lengthen the amount of time they have to be on those cell phones and find each other.
Pardis, what else do you think the United States and people believe in freedom should be doing to support the protesters?
I think that one of the most important things that also makes it different this time is I think people need to realize this is not just a feminist issue or not just an issue for about women or women and girls. This is a human rights issue, right? I think that one of the things folks are now seeing is that whether you're a feminist or not, whether you fall into that silo here in the United States, this is a much larger issue about human rights and freedom. And you see that in the powerful chants that folks are screaming on the streets of Iran today.
You know, Tara, you were in your one of your responsibilities as Undersecretary of State was public affairs. So the following is right up your alley. I don't know if you heard Steve Inskeep on NPR yesterday interviewing Iran's foreign minister. And when Inskeep asked if he felt the protesters had legitimate reasons for protest. Here's what the Iranian foreign minister said in response. Something happened to her that made all of us very sad. Similar incidents happen all around the world, like tons of examples similar to that in the United States or the UK. What's the appropriate response to that for the US to have credibility in this matter?
The appropriate response is no moral equivalence. What is happening in Iran is unlike anything that happens in the West. I think what it shows is Iran's crisis of legitimacy, that they have to now try to walk back a bit, try to equate Iran's behavior with the UK or the US. This is the moment that women around the world, men, boys, your program and others have to stay at this day in and day out. The messaging, the words matter, the narrative matters. We just cannot look sideways or look away from this.
One last thing, Pardis. As I'm sure you know, I'm not sure everybody watching knows, the United States has tried to get the Iran nuclear deal back in place. Talks apparently broke off, but there's still a desire on the part of the United States to reimpose that agreement or renegotiate that agreement. Is continuing that negotiations a help or a hindrance to the effort of people on the streets of Iran?
You know, I think that the issue is going to be this question of the legitimacy of the regime, right? And so, you know, having the United States continue to engage in the regime, you know, does that, as Tara said a moment earlier, does that legitimize then the regime? Are there ways in which the United States can support, you know, the more organic movements that we're now seeing in the street? I think that's something that we need to take a good hard look at. At the same time, as I've been following the talks around the U.S.-Iran nuclear deal, one of the things that we're seeing and scholars around the country here are talking about is that the deal is appearing quite different than, you know, when John Kerry was initially brokering it. Mm-hmm. And so I think we need to take a hard look at why the deal has changed so significantly in these past few years.
Tara, can you take the last 15 seconds and weigh on that too, please?
Yes. I mean, during the time when we had Soviet dissidents, we still managed to negotiate arms control with Soviets. And we cordoned off, we compartmentalized. We did what we could, though, to keep our eyes on the human rights. And yes, we will negotiate nuclear treaties and we will do economic sanctions. But at this moment in time, we stand with the people of Iran and their expressions of frustration, rage, and resentment at what's been four decades of unfair treatment.
Tara Sonenshine, Pardis Mahdavi, thank you both for your time and your work. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.